want to give you one personal anecdote about myself, which for me has always sort of defined the kind of work that I do. I've been a geriatric social worker for basically 40 years. So I'm in my 60s now, so I started this kind of work in my 20s. And back then in the 1970s, I would go to parties and I'd be standing around with my glass of beer like everybody else, and people would say to me, "Well, what do you do?" And I would say, "I'm a geriatric social worker. I work with older adults and their family members." People would look at me, they would step back, and they would have one of two responses. The nicer response was, "Oh, I'm so glad there are people like you out there. I mean, that's terrible work, but thank goodness somebody's willing to do it." And the more common response was the person would step back and say, "You do what? Ugh, you know, why?" And then they would walk away. Well, now suffice it to say, when I go to parties, I'm the most popular person there. Now, keeping with our topic about cultivating the gift of preparedness and the art of accepting aging with dignity, I'm going to be asking each panelist a specific question. Dr. Henson, I will start with you. First question, what should we be doing to keep our brains healthy? And what is the latest research showing about preserving good brain health?
Hi there. It's actually pretty easy. It's all the things that you know you were supposed to do and your mom told you to do when you were growing up. So. The first thing is you're supposed to stay physically active. And we know that the more physically active you are, the better off you are in terms of your brain. It actually increases the blood supply to your brain. And we've actually shown that physical exercise is actually even more important than cognitive exercise. So all those luminosity games that you play are not as important as going out for a walk or getting on your bike and exercising. Sorry, guys. The other things that are important is you have to be good to your heart. So specifically the things that you know you're supposed to be doing in terms of keeping your blood pressure under control, keeping your cholesterol under control, keeping your blood sugars under control, keeping your weight under control, all of those things, again, because it contributes to your overall health, is actually really important to your brain. Eating a good diet. So the diets that are generally recommended are things like the Mediterranean diet, low fat. You know, you might as well be a monk. But anyway, you know, you eat a low fat diet, a diet that's high in fruits and fiber, limit the amount of red meat that you eat. You eat more poultry and chicken. Alcohol in moderation is really important. The other things that are important are not smoking. So smoking, again, clogs up those arteries to your brain, and so it's actually bad for you. And if you do smoke, it's actually not too late to quit, because there's studies that have shown that you can actually make up the difference by stopping smoking at any point. It's also important to actually keep your brain physically healthy, and by that I mean your head. So wearing your seatbelt, Sid, wearing your bike helmet when you're out biking, or your motorcycle helmet if you're out riding your motorcycle. Preventing falls, don't hit the ground with your head, because head injuries are actually bad for your brain, as we know from the evidence with football players and people who have boxers, for example. The other things that we know that are good for your head are getting enough sleep. So I told you these are all the things your mother told you you should be doing anyway, but getting enough sleep is actually really important in terms of keeping your brain healthy. Keeping healthy from a mental standpoint is really important. So socializing, hanging out with friends, volunteering, participating in clubs, doing things that are that get you interacting with other people socially is really, really important. And then also treating mental illness such as depression, which is very common. And depression can actually be one of the, can actually look like dementia. And so it's a good neurologist, if you go in and you're worried about your memory, one of the first things we'll do is we'll actually evaluate you for your depression and see whether or not that is a problem. And then the other things that are important are doing your cognitive exercises, challenging yourself. The more you learn and the more you push yourself both physically and mentally, the better off it is for your brain because you set up new pathways. Now I'm blanking on the other thing that you're supposed to be doing. But anyway.
Oh, dear. Let me see. This is really funny. No, I think that's it. I think I've covered it all. I obviously didn't get enough sleep last night.
Our second question is for Dan. Dan, can you tell us what are the legal plans we should be making as we age? What are the documents we should have in place? And also, could you comment on the cost of long-term care and how to finance it?
Excellent questions, Moira. Thank you. And like Moira, I've had the same experience at cocktail parties. What do you do? I'm an elder care attorney. What is that? So this is a great opportunity to let y'all know there is such a thing as that. And if you happen to meet one, don't say, what is that? So it, taking those two topics and breaking them apart, in terms of the documents, obviously everybody here knows that you should have a will and an estate plan, and that often can include tax planning, that can include charitable planning. But the two documents that I would want to call attention to more now, more than anything else, really don't have anything to do with your assets. They have to do with decision-making authority in the event that you or a loved one loses capacity to make their own decisions. And so those are powers of attorney, which break down into two categories. One is a financial or a business power of attorney. This is a document that can be springing. In other words, it can be, its validity can be triggered based on the occurrence of an event. For example, a certification from your treating physician that you've lost your capacity to make, use good judgment and make decisions. Or it can be made effective immediately. For those parents who have children in their 20s and 30s who don't quite trust them yet, a springing power of attorney can be a good solution. There used to be three documents in Georgia, and now there are just two. The other two used to be the durable health care power of attorney and what was called a living will. And so if I asked for a show of hands, I'd see probably a lot of hands going up relating to the fact that you know what a living will is and maybe you even have one. And so everyone here should be aware that in 2007, Georgia's legislature, in response to the Terry Schiavo case down in Florida, revamped our statutory code relating to the Medical Advance Directive. And so now, instead of having the durable health care power of attorney and the living will, we just have a single document called the Georgia Advance Directive for Healthcare, which is a combined document. You don't need a lawyer to get it. Just Google the phrase Georgia Advance Directive for Healthcare. There are some other variations of it. I know that there used to be one Piedmont used called the Critical Conditions Guide. I know other hospitals have one. But from a statutory standpoint, the Georgia law has what's called the Georgia Advance Directive for Healthcare. And in that document, you can both name an agent and also address the questions relating to what used to be in a living will. So if you're in a persistent vegetative state, if you're in a coma, if you're in a terminal illness, and you don't want life-sustaining procedures implemented, if you don't want nutrition and hydration, which were the issues in the Terry Schiavo case down in Florida, then you need to have an advance directive for healthcare, and you actually need to provide it to your physician and all of your family. Make sure everybody knows what your wishes are, because putting it in a safety deposit box and not telling anyone what your wishes are really doesn't accomplish anything. And because time is limited, I'm going to shift to the second topic she raised, which is the cost of care, which, as you guys can imagine, with the baby boomers aging, we have a tsunami approaching, which is the need for care and the cost of that care. And so I think one of the other speakers is going to be spending more time defining what those types of care are, but just as a heading, you have home care, you have assisted living care, and you have nursing care. Subsets of that are, there is such a thing as independent living, and there's also dementia care assisted living, which falls under the heading of assisted living. So the cost of that type of care, if you haven't had any experience with this with a spouse or a parent or a loved one, in-home care in Metro Atlanta, you're looking at somewhere around $20 an hour if you choose to utilize a licensed, insured, bonded home care company. And I typically recommend that from a payroll tax standpoint, from having substitutes if your primary caregiver is sick or on vacation, working with somebody under the table, your neighbor's niece who's in nursing school, it really isn't a reliable long-term solution. Assisted living care in Metro Atlanta, anywhere from $2,500 to $5,000 a month, private pay. Dementia care assisted living, you're looking at $4,500 to $6,500 a month in Metro Atlanta. And private nursing care, you're looking at $7,000 to about $9,500 a month. So you're suddenly talking about $80,000 to $100,000 a year for private pay. The reason this is such a big deal, and I proposed to Moira that it come up today, is because so many people, they want to plan for who receives property after they pass through their estate plan, but they maybe don't plan for the cost of the care that's going to precede their passing, meaning there may be nothing left. And so I think it's important to account for whether VA benefits might be an option, what Medicare will pay for, which, you know, we don't have time to cover all this, how Medicaid can play a role. And in fact, somewhere around 80 to 85% of all nursing home care in Georgia is financed by Medicaid, and also long-term care insurance, which is something that our banker can talk more about as well. So those are some of the amounts, the different ways they can be financed. And I guess the last thing I would say is that you should not assume that you or your loved one can't qualify, even if you have some assets, because the rules, especially here in Georgia, do allow for that possibility, even if you do have some assets. So, thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Paul, to expand the conversation about financing long-term care, in your experience as a certified financial planner, could you tell us about it, from your perspective, what preparations we should be making for later life? And also, could you comment on what family caregivers need to know as they help their older adults with their health care? Specifically commenting on not just the direct costs of care, but the indirect costs as well.
Right, I think that's a great point. We, in most everything, we always see the direct impact of things. We sometimes forget about what we don't always see or don't always think about. One of the big things that we like to stress when we are meeting with families about this issue is that no matter what your financial station in life is, money cannot prevent the aging process. It cannot prevent health decline. So really, preparation is going to be more important than what your assets are. Assets certainly are going to make it a little bit easier to finance some of the things that Dan alluded to. But let's talk a little bit about some of the direct and indirect costs, whether it's hard dollar costs or it's maybe something a little bit more intangible, both from the patient's perspective as well as the caregiver's perspective. Because when you talk about something like memory loss or dementia or Alzheimer's, it's not just a patient, it's a family issue. When you think about the fact that there's typically going to be, at least at the outset, a family member is going to be pretty heavily involved, there's going to be impact to more than just the financial aspect of that patient. So a couple of things to think about, both from the patient's perspective as well as the potential caregiver's perspective, are maybe the patient who becomes afflicted was planning to work and receive employment income to, let's say, age 62 or 65. Well, if all of a sudden there is an issue that prevents them from doing the same kind of work, now you have a loss of income issue. So that's one of the main, I think, financial aspects to think about, whether it's to the patient or to their caregiver. So when you look at that from the caregiver's perspective, it's not unusual to see, let's say, 20 hours a week for a family member that might be involved with caring for their family member that is in health decline. So that's one of the big issues that we see before you even start getting to the direct expenses of potential assisted living or skilled nursing care facilities. So a couple of the other items that are not uncommon for us to see, and certainly that we like to address with clients that we're advising, is when you think about the whole concept of, at least initially, the whole idea of aging in place. You know, most people would prefer, if they can, to stay in their own homes. So now you have issues potentially related to, do we have to make modifications to the home to make it more accessible or make it more conducive to the afflictions that the patient potentially has? So that's certainly a direct expense that we can see with patients that are suffering from memory impairment. We have the other expenses related to in-home care that Dan alluded to, whether it's non-skilled type care, just helping around the house with housekeeping type issues, meal preparation, laundry, cleaning, those types of things. Obviously, transportation becomes a pretty big deal if the patient is unable to get themselves around from one place to another. So that's another expense to keep in mind. The home accessibility issues, the good news is that we are, I think, at this intersection where technology is making pretty significant advances for potential Alzheimer's and dementia patients, so that aging in the home can, I think, be stretched out a little bit longer than maybe it has in the past. So if you look at some of the things related to home monitoring systems, sensors on doors to that gauge whether or not our potential patient has left the home or is still in the home, pillbox dispensers, there are, and I'm certainly not a medical expert, but there's technology. I think GE and Intel have a partnership on some technology that literally can monitor vital signs and some of these other things related to the aging and in-home process that make it easier for the caregiver to the patient, as well as their medical team, to have real-time access to what is going on with that patient. Are they eating their meals? Are they taking their medications that they might need to? So there's a number of different items before you even get to the point of potentially incurring some of the significant expenses that Dan was alluding to related to an assisted living type situation or a continuing care retirement community or a skilled nursing facility. So that's just, I think, the big picture summary we wanted to get across. When you think about what is the cost of this, it's more than just a potential monthly expense related to a facility.
And to expand in a broader sense about what's available for older adults in the community in terms of how Atlanta is becoming more older adult friendly, Kathryn, can you discuss how Atlanta is becoming more focused on our aging population? And also, can you tell us about neighborhoods that are intentionally planning for their aging residents?
Well, first I wanted to mention that I think I have an even worse situation at parties than Moira or Dan does, because I do public policy as it relates to aging older adults. But even harder, I found that when my children were very young, they asked my husband, what do you do? And he's an architect, so it was really easy to understand that he builds buildings. And then they asked me, and I realized I wouldn't have anything good to say, so I just told them I was Superwoman. And for a while they believed it, and then one Saturday I had to bring them to the office with me to pick up some files I had forgotten, and they let me know that for Superwoman I had a pretty small office. So I do think, however, one of the reasons we're here and this incredible topic is because, the truth be told, and the data is that every one of you are Superman and Superwoman, because we are living so much longer than ever before. If it was this same gathering 100 years ago, most of us would have far surpassed life expectancy, and we probably wouldn't have been here, right? The turn of last century was 47 life expectancy, and by the turn of the 20th century, we were in the high 70s, low 80s for women. And many people are estimating that young girls born today will have a life expectancy of 100. And so I think it's always really important when we think about this, and certainly when we talk about neighborhood planning, that we emphasize longevity, because it is this whole wonderful thing of living so much longer, which is going to help us think about things differently and help us plan and prepare. But the truth about aging is it doesn't happen on a single day. And it's very hard to meet anyone who's actually aging, I have found. It doesn't matter how old they are. It's usually the guy next to them. So aging isn't really necessarily the start and end point, here we are, but we have to think about a life that's going to be lived so much longer. And our challenges with our neighborhoods in Atlanta is that we did this funny thing, which we froze ourselves in time, and we built neighborhoods that work for only a little bit of our lives, and the rest of our lives, we try to cope with it. And there are three main things that our neighborhoods have challenges with here in Atlanta. And Atlanta, by the way, was ranked as the city with the fastest growing older adult population. Shocker, right? Because Atlanta, we're young. That's what we always said about ourselves. And, you know, I think we can keep saying it, but the data shows that we're actually the fastest growing older adult population in the country. So our challenges are that we have designed our communities for different kinds of bodies and minds. And what we need are incredibly flexible communities, because a lot of stuff happens when we're going to live this much longer. And so we've got a big issue with transportation. So neighborhoods, and that's, I mean, who here enjoyed driving to get here? I don't think it happens one morning when you're older. It's really unpleasant at all ages in the Atlanta region, but it becomes absolutely a big issue. And not to keep throwing statistics, but Atlanta as a region was ranked the worst place for baby boomers in terms of their access to anything but the car. And before that study came out, the authors called us at our office and said, we just need to warn you because it's going to be on NPR and whatever. We said, well, at least when you're worst, you can only go up from there. Who wants to be middle of the road on stuff? So we're the worst when it comes to transportation options for where baby boomers are living right now. Transportation is a big challenge, and it's just that we need options. Because there are really important times to drive, but it's also really important to have other ways to get around, biking and walking. And so we do have some good things that are happening in Atlanta and some things that are likely to happen because of some investments that we could be making. The other big issue for neighborhoods is housing choice. So to be able to live in a community for as long as possible, we need to do all of the things that have already been mentioned. Stay healthy and think and make our plans and preparations and think about choices and possibilities so we know how we want others to work with us to make decisions. But we also need to have choices, and housing choice is a particular challenge, because if you decide that when you're younger you need more space, or if you decide when you're older you need less space and you're tired of mowing the lawn, most people in our area have to leave their neighborhood to find the housing option they need. And those are rules that we have in place, and some places are looking at changing those rules. And the last thing is neighborhoods that make it easy to do all of the things that the doctor pointed out, which is if it is easy and safe for you to get out and be active, you will do it, and you'll do it throughout your lifetime. And as she already mentioned, it's incredibly important to do older, in their older years. And that is everything from sidewalks to lighting to wonderful investments, like you know about the Beltline and other trails and access, but also having some place to go. Who wants to walk to nowhere? It's important to have a place to walk and maybe get a cup of coffee or grab the newspaper or be able to stop by the bank and get some of your business done.
I'm certain that many, many of you in this room today are caring for a family member or perhaps a close friend. Could be a spouse or a partner or a parent or a sibling or a dear friend who is in declining health because of a chronic health problem such as dementia. We find at 60 plus that caregivers experience a tremendous amount of anxiety and second guessing of themselves and guilt because they fear that they're not doing it well enough. And I just want to take a minute to put this into perspective. The whole issue of caregiving and being a family caregiver is a relatively recent phenomenon. When you look back, I can think of when I'm 64, when I was growing up in the 1950s, it was a big deal if somebody made it to a 25-year wedding anniversary. Their picture would be in the local paper. If they made it to 50 years married, they were like super old. Well, now that's nothing. It's really common for people to be married for 70 years or longer. And as we age and as somebody in the family becomes ill, someone else has to care for them. And as we've heard, this can become very, very expensive. If you're hiring care at home, if you're seeking a long-term care facility, these are very expensive things. And family members struggle with how to do this well, and they also very often forget their own needs in the process. They may not be getting enough sleep, they may become socially isolated, and they can really suffer with clinical depression themselves as a result. And so we like to acknowledge them at 60 plus, and when we work with a family, we often say to the family, you know what, we're more concerned about you, the family caregiver, even than we are about the older patient in your family. Because if you're not functioning well enough, where will they be? So I just want to say that acknowledging caregiver stress and encouraging family caregivers to be honest with themselves about how stressed out they are, talk to their own doctors about their stress, about their poor sleep habits or their change in appetite or their lack of seeing friends. These are very important issues to address. And attending caregiver support groups can be hugely helpful in that regard. We're very fortunate at 60 plus. We facilitate 3 dementia caregiver support groups here in Buckhead, and we can certainly give anyone more information about those groups if you're interested. So keep that in mind if you're a caregiver. Try to take good care of yourself. Another question that I'm going to go on to for our panelists is, can each of you comment about having difficult conversations with family members? And maybe you have some suggestions for us about how to do that, about any range of topics that we should be addressing as we get older. And Dr. Henson, I'd like to start with you specifically on that. Can you comment on having a difficult conversation with someone about driving?
It's one of the things that makes me as the physician incredibly unpopular with my patients. It's not a fun conversation, especially in America, where we count on our automobiles as a mode of transportation, as a reflection of ourselves. Our identity is very much tied to our cars. It's a very difficult thing to have that conversation. One of the things I try to remind patients about is the fact that just around the statistics. So I found these statistics from the Georgia State Highway, which I thought was really interesting, that first of all, drivers over the age of 65 have the highest driver crash fatality rate in the state, great over any other age group, including teenagers. So if you're worried about your teenage kids driving, worry more about your parents who are over the age of 65. And in those, in the accidents, more than 69% of patients died, people died when older adults were involved. I have patients who say, well, I only drive to the grocery store. So it's an area I know, I only drive during daylight hours. Well, in fact, the statistics show that the accidents that most commonly occur during break days between the hours of 12 noon to 3 p.m. And in fact, if you look at the statistics around accidents, most accidents occur within 2 miles of home. So it's specifically driving to the grocery store that doesn't really protect you from yourself. The problem with dementia in particular is that people lose insight and awareness of the things that you know, we could have this conversation and with any of us in this room, and we say, gosh, that doesn't really make sense for you to be driving, and it's a very logical thing. But the thing that we don't remember is that patients with dementia lose insight, lose the ability to have that logical thought. So frequently the conversation has to occur with family members. And unfortunately, for the sake of the safety of the patient and for the safety of the public, a lot of times, as a physician, I have to come up with a conspiracy that will allow us to, unfortunately, take the keys away. Sometimes we have a car stolen because truly, you know, we have, you can hide the keys. You think it's funny, but, you know, I've had family members hide the keys, but that doesn't do you any good because, you know, an enterprising senior will call someone up and get a new pair of car keys. But if you steal the car, sometimes it's a little harder to go out and buy a new car. Although I actually had a patient do that as well. I had a patient who was really wealthy, call up a cab, took him to the local, you know, Lincoln dealer, he bought himself a new car. So it's pretty hard to have that discussion in a logical fashion, unfortunately. Fortunately, in this state, you can actually request the state make a evaluation of a driver if you're worried about it. It cannot be anonymous, so if you're going to report on mom, you have to actually put down your name, otherwise the state won't do the investigation. But they do try to keep you, you know, keep your confidentiality, but it's not an easy conversation. It's really around convincing family members that they have an obligation not only to their loved one, but also to the public that is so critical.
I'll chime in here for a second on the driving issue. In our dementia caregiver support groups at 60 plus, driving comes up all the time among people who are attending our groups. And we talk a lot about the concept of ethical lying, which Dr. Henson just gave a great example of, and how with someone who has dementia, that can be a kinder and more compassionate way to approach this extremely serious topic of not being able to drive anymore. And it does require a lot of creativity. One daughter I worked with years ago who just said to me, I can't lie to my mother about anything. I know she has bad Alzheimer's disease at this point, but I can't lie to her. So I'm going to call it creative communication. It's fine. But the point being, it is on the family, as Dr. Henson said, to even if you go to the state of Georgia and they evaluate the patient and send a certified letter to the patient saying you can no longer drive, someone has to enforce it and make sure that the person doesn't get behind the wheel again. So, and that's it's a big responsibility. So regarding other difficult conversations, does anyone want to chime in?
I have a couple of comments. First, as far as the driving question go, there's actually a liability issue. So once somebody has been notified you shouldn't drive, the fact that they're enterprising and they do drive, if something happens, you're looking at a serious liability issue. And so, you don't want to hurt someone's feelings, but you also, especially if there's a spouse whose financial future could be jeopardized by liability created by an accident, it's, you know, leave it to the lawyer to bring that up. But the bottom line is there's a liability issue you want to be careful about. Also to follow up on the comment about the physician being the bad guy, my experience and my guess is for some of you as well is that it doesn't matter how old an adult child is, they are still little Susie or little Johnny to mom or dad. And so I'm actually going through this right now with my own parents and my father's health issues and trying to get all their ducks in a row. I've been doing this almost 25 years and my own parents don't want to listen to me or take advice from me. And so the point I want to make about that is that it's critical to build a team of qualified people around the person needing care, and that it's far more likely that that person who needs care is going to listen to a perceived external expert who's being paid something as opposed to an adult child. Now, the being paid part isn't necessarily critical, and I guess I revert to that point because if you have the opportunity to work with 60 plus and work with somebody like Moira, you know, she's actually gonna get in the trenches and their staff are gonna get in there and they can actually be the bad guy. I'm often the bad guy, especially on that caregiver burnout issue, and the fact that spouses generally don't, that the well spouse doesn't necessarily even think of herself or him, yourself. They're thinking that the marriage consists 99% of my spouse and I'm just 1%, when in reality you really need it to be balanced 50-50, and getting people to realize that and have that conversation with the kids is important. And then finally, especially for the men out there, it's very difficult to have a conversation with them about what their physical limitations are, because we men don't like to recognize that we can't climb ladders anymore, and we can't. I actually have a client who cut a tree down with a chainsaw and it fell on himself. He's now paralyzed and needs long-term care because he made a choice that he shouldn't have made regarding what he used to be able to do. So I would encourage all of you to think about your own limitations, and certainly if you're a caregiver, the limitations of those you're caring for, and find gentle ways to encourage them to respect those limits, as opposed to something even as simple as going down a sloped driveway to get the mail can end up being a problem. So have those conversations.
I just want to add one additional thought to this, and that is that I think as a society, we have to find a new way of framing these issues, because if it's only going to be about loss, then we should all probably adopt the strategy of, you know, going kicking and screaming. But in fact, living much longer has these tremendous benefits, but we have a huge shift we need to make as a community and society so that everything doesn't have to be framed as loss. And each of those individual horrible conversations about just the keys, let alone all of these other issues, are the result of not always just the personal changes, but the fact that those keys mean everything. They mean independence, they mean freedom. They're the result of a singular investment in only one way of getting around. And if we're gonna look at the 21st century, where this is here to stay, right? We're going to live this much longer forever. This whole century will be dominated by longevity. And I think our success, both as individuals and families, has to be fueled by our willingness as a community to tackle some of these issues in a different way. What I would love to hear is that in 20 years, we're up here and none of us have the war stories of taking keys away. And I'll just close by saying the only reason my grandmother allows a woman to come and drive her is because she thinks that woman needs the job. So.
I think that's a really wonderful, wonderful point about individualizing for the person you care about in your family, how some of these really tough issues can be approached with them. One question I want to present to the panel too is, what about older family members who are resistant to signing advance directives, powers of attorney for healthcare and finances, because they might perceive that that's giving up some of their independence, and they say, oh, I'll do that in my own time, but they don't get it done. Any creative ways of handling that?
I just wanted to add something on the last topic, and I'm going to probably defer to Dan on the legal aspects. In our space, in the asset management business and the trust companies, I know at my firm, as well as most of the firms that are in this space around town, it's not unusual for us, when we're typically working with a senior generation family, and starting to think about the next generation and some of the estate planning that Dan alluded to earlier. One of the things that we typically try to offer, maybe as an icebreaker, is let's host a family meeting with the children. And we don't have to necessarily discuss numbers, because not all of our clients are prepared to say, here's how much and when. So it doesn't have to be that much disclosure and transparency if our clients are not prepared for that. But it is an icebreaker in the sense that we are now getting generation one and generation two together, whether it's once a year, once every couple of years, to talk through the whole idea of, here's what mom and dad are doing as it relates to our estate and just the whole aging process. So I think if we can frame it from that perspective, as opposed to just a money discussion. It then gives generation two and three the opportunity to talk to the parents and maybe open up the conversation in a little less threatening way about what have you done in respect to if your health goes into decline. So I just wanted to point that out related to the last question, but I'm sure Dan has some comments on the legal part as well.
So the comments that you just made and also that were made prior about changing perspective, which you just suggested is actually consistent with that, which is including conversations among generations, which before you even said that, I was going to pose the point that what I found is that it's very important to take baby steps and to not just take one giant leap for mankind by going from nothing to the keys are being taken away. And so I've already admitted that things aren't going exactly as I hope with my own parents, but the reality is that I have been trying to implement this concept, which is to have conversations earlier, before there are health concerns, to plant seeds so that people get accustomed to the idea that times will change and maybe I will need help at some point and maybe I should consider a power of attorney someday, even if it's not today, because eventually, after you create enough momentum, you will create an open mind to that possibility, which ties directly in with this revised vision of what loss is and this ridiculous idea that I am going to cling to the front porch post with my fingernails dug in, thinking that being in this empty house by myself with poor nutrition and hydration and depressed actually represents everything is okay because I'm still at home. And instead, encouraging generations to care for generations, which sometimes our culture isn't the best about. Encouraging people to think about, to use creative communication to get mom to maybe go out to lunch. And oh, by the way, lunch is at an assisted living facility where there's a dining room where she enjoys a nice lunch and meets somebody that she can play canasta with. The next thing you know, suddenly letting go of the front porch post isn't so painful. So I've actually had numerous clients over the years tell me, I wish I would have considered moving to assisted living sooner because I can play cards, I can go on outings, there's an arts and crafts room, I can do carpentry, a million different things that are far better for the person's interaction with other people, keeping them stimulated, keeping their brain working, because they're not just sitting in an empty house watching The Price is Right over and over again. So in terms of the question regarding what happens if somebody pushes back, you know, obviously there's a couple of legal mechanisms that exist, but those are worst case scenarios. One is an involuntary commitment, which often comes up in the context of drug or alcohol abuse, but also can be a part of somebody who's suffering from dementia, which is the worst case scenario. In between a power of attorney and that is the idea of that you can get a guardianship or a conservatorship, which are the corollaries to the medical power of attorney and the financial power of attorney. A conservator manages finances through a court order. A guardian makes medical decisions and personal decisions through a court order. These are things that follow what can often be a very contentious and expensive and time-consuming process in court, basically a lawsuit. So that's climbing Mount Everest. Getting good powers of attorney, advanced directives in place, is just hiking up the back of Stone Mountain. So it's a big difference, and obviously it's a secondary option, which is why you want to plant those seeds and you want to try and encourage the documents be done early rather than wait to the last second, because there actually is a capacity threshold, which is actually one of the biggest challenges to the growth of my practice. So many people call up and say, I'd like to come and see you about mom or dad. And I say, do you have power of attorney? And they say no. And I say, well, then I can't meet with you. And then bad things happen financially and somebody doesn't get the care that they need, all because the documents were put in place ahead of time.
Dr. Henson, could you come? Sure.
So I have two stories. I don't want Dan to feel lonely, so I'll give some personal examples. You know, one of the things I think it's really important is that we all feel like we always have tomorrow to plan. And to your point exactly is that you never know when, as we all get older, you never know when something is going to happen. And so the more proactive we are about planning for our kids' future, the better off we are. And one example is I have an aunt who is widowed and have no children and very well off. And she's got this ginormous house, which she's always filled up with tons of things because she could afford to buy them. And she became incapacitated because of a stroke and had to move in with her sister. And what had to happen was all of her nieces and nephews had to drive into her home, go to her home, and empty out her home of all of these things which were treasures to her, but she had not really thought through and planned through what would happen to them when she could no longer take care of herself. And to me, the tragedy was what the nieces and nephews had to go through because, unfortunately, this aunt hadn't really thought that through. The other piece is that my children's grandparents on their father's side is very wealthy. And, you know, I'd always known that they would be well, my kids would be well cared for because my ex-in-laws had money that they had set aside in trust funds for the kids. But they were also very worried that about sharing that information because they didn't want their kids or their grandkids to want, you know, to want something bad to happen to them because of their money. Well, sadly enough, both my in-laws have dementia, and the problem now is we don't know where that money is. And at the end of the day, there's a lot of forensic work that has to occur to help find those assets, not because it's important that they go to my kids or my ex-husband, but because they've worked hard for that money, right? They really had set that money aside so that their families and their loved ones could be cared for. But because we had not thought through the idea of how do you transmit that information to the people who need to know about it when you're no longer capable, it's really a bit of a disaster. So I'll give you my own example. When my husband and I moved here from Seattle a year ago, I thought through everything that I was packing because I didn't want my kids, even though things meant a lot to me, I didn't want to make the assumption that my kids would actually ever want those things. And it's really important to make a list of all of our assets so that if we get hit by a car tomorrow, they know where the safe, what the lock, the combination to the safe deposit box is and where all these accounts are. We have all this information in our cell phones, in our computers, in terms of all of our investments. But at the end of the day, do people really know how to pull that information out there? I wanted to get back to the original question that Mara asked about having the very difficult conversation about living advanced directives and things such as do you want CPR done and do you want IV fluids and do you want antibiotics? And you know, most people, when you have that very general conversation about do you want everything done for you, the answer is of course I do. I mean, why on earth would I give up the opportunity to have all of, you know, the wonders of modern healthcare taken away from me? But what I find is that it's really helpful to have a very graphic discussion about what that means. And you know, we see enough shows on television about people having CPR done on them and whatnot. But I actually have a very frank conversation with my patients about what it means to have chest compressions in terms of ribs being broken, what it means to have someone breathing for you and having a breathing tube placed. And then the things, and that's really dramatic, and it's the thing that most people have an idea in their head about. But the harder conversation is actually around nutrition and around IV antibiotics. And the reason for that is, you know, a lot of people will say, well, gosh, I don't want all that violent stuff done to me if something bad happens to me. But it's harder to make a decision about, do you want to not be fed? Do you want to be not given fluids? And the cause of death for many people with dementia is actually pneumonia. It's, you know, old man's best friend. And we have antibiotics to treat that. But at the end of the day, when you've treated your sixth pneumonia, because that's really what nature does when you have dementia, it's your time, is it really, do you really want to have that? For some people, it may be the right answer, and I think we need to be respectful that each person has their own decision about how many courses of antibiotics they want or don't want. But at the end of the day, unless you think that through and understand what it means to have that course of antibiotics, that it means prolonging life until the next episode of pneumonia, it's very difficult for most lay people to get their heads around. The other part of it is, you know, having the conversation about most people don't want to think about starving to death when you talk about withdrawing nutrition. But, you know, our bodies are wonderful things that turn off information that isn't pleasant. So for patients who make the decision that they don't want IV fluids, so they don't want two feedings to prolong their lives when there's nothing else that can be done, our brains shut down so that we're not aware of our environment. It's actually very, very peaceful. And for a lot of patients, they need to hear that that's, you know, it's not this painful end that sometimes we think of. So I think that that's a really important graphic discussion that has to happen for people to make good decisions for themselves individually. Because each person will have a different feeling.
If I can just add to that as well, as we all anticipate how we will live out our lives and our personal decisions about end-of-life care, as Dr. Henson was mentioning, I would also like to encourage everyone to think about this question. Who do you imagine is going to care for you if you cannot care for yourself? I think we have been very good in getting much better in our healthcare system to record our specific wishes regarding end-of-life care, pain management, aggressive medical treatment, and things of that nature. But the reality is, most of us these days, because of fabulous advances in medical care, say for heart treatment, for example, there's so many more great heart medications available now. So people are living much longer, but perhaps in a frailer state of health. And they might, you know, it's very common now for people not to die suddenly, to slowly decline. So the question becomes, who's going to care for me if I become in that situation? And I think that that's a really important question to think through and have conversations with people who are close to you now to really try to establish that. You know, will you be there for me? I'm imagining that you will. Is that right? And if the person isn't going to be there for you, who else might be? That's something I've learned in my job over the years is that's an important area to consider.
I think what everyone has begun to recognize, whether they're working with the hospital or any other facet of the healthcare system, is that there is absolutely no way we're going to do this alone. So that the only reasonable, viable solutions to enhancing quality of life for everyone throughout their lifespan is through incredibly powerful partnerships. So for hospitals to be successful, they have to be integrated with community services. For community services to be successful, they have to be delivered within quality communities that support rather than hinder good, healthy living. And that whole new approach is impacting all of the way we work, but it's also the expectation that our consumers have. No one accepts anymore the idea of silos. They expect us to be able to work together to fundamentally address these issues.
10 years from now, the majority of the cars on the roads will be driverless cars. So I would think, and I mean, I'd like to hear not just that, but other technologies that you see that will make all of our lives better.
Well, do any of you use Uber? That's one that's really changing the way we think about folks who don't prefer to drive, get around. Yeah, absolutely, right? So I think the most important thing is that it's not only that technology, but how fast technology is changing. So the thing that we actually have to do is not accept that technology is going to be part of the solution, because that's a given. So that's not an option. It's here to stay. But we also have to get accustomed to how fast technology moves. Because you know what I actually think, and I think my boss agrees, is that driverless cars are going to look silly by the end of the century, right? They're like hard to even imagine now, and by 2050 they're going to be so outdated, you know? They're going to be like, who's got the driverless car now, you know? So, I mean, it is changing so fast. So we don't get to have this linear process of planning, investment, and see the outcome. It has to be rapid. Deployment of new ideas, see what works, see what doesn't, and get back out there and try again. And that's our century now. So it's not what role will technology play, it's how fast can we accommodate. And is Atlanta going to be a hotbed of innovation, or is Atlanta going to be the last place to adopt things? And there's lots, we do have choices to make about that. And that's in healthcare and aging and transportation and just about everything.
Thank you so much for having us today. Let me just say that if any of you are, if you have any questions about any aspects of aging, please contact us at 60 Plus Services. I also want to say that we are now formal partners with Piedmont's new Senior Wellness Center, which provides primary care. So let us know if we can be of any help.